Yeah, these gang boxes.
Well, Chris is turning out to be another crew member that came along with a lot of tools. He's got a pipe threader in there. Oh my God, no more hand threading, no welding. So this is Doug and this is SV Seeker. And we're putting in the hydraulic system, at least the major plumbing for the hydraulic system, because we have a crew member here that knows that stuff.
This is Chris from Minnesota, so he doesn't even mind the winter. He thinks it's warm.
Yeah, this is for you.
Yeah?
That's like chain bugs.
Oh, that's what you're talking about. Yeah, it's just like the ones on the...
Yep, exact
man,
same
the rigid.
Except now you guys can mount it down low and...
On the table.
That'd be nice. Yeah.
Now you don't have to have the big tripod vise.
A pipe bender.
Conduit bender.
You're right. You'll never see us in a harness.
Yep.
It's called a boating seat. It's got a piece of wood with some two ropes going to it.
See, I got a harness that's got one of those built into it because I do rope access.
Yeah.
Just because
I'm not
going to
arrange the rope in until this weekend. Oh, is that what it is?
Yep.
That looks just like the Harbor Freight one.
Yeah, except the Harbor Freight one's a piece of shit. I've bought those and thrown them away after one job. Oh. This is the portable.
This is what the real one looks like.
If I would have brought one of the big ones, we've got a...
You got the machine. Yeah, you got the stands for now.
Now we're back. We went down and got some A106 seamless steel pipe, Schedule 80. And that'll do about 4,000 PSI. I swear that's cheating. That would have taken at least 15 minutes to do by hand.
$1.50 a roll threading, the Teflon tape.
How many times did you go around?
Three or four times.
Yeah. And then you put the dope on top of it.
Yep.
So the dope seals and the Teflon tape, you said, makes it smoother to thread on.
Usually allows it to bury further. There we go.
Thread the part on and then get your second measurement?
Yep. Otherwise, I don't know half time what's sitting there.
Wimpy pipe wrenches. They're made out of aluminum so they don't weigh anything. And they're made by Rigid. So I imagine they cost about five times what you pay for the Harbor Freight ones. But if I was going to do it all day long, that's the tool I'd want. That's a tool for somebody that's going to do this every day.
This is the surface we're clamping to.
How do you determine what the length is?
You just kind of know how far it's going to bury into
there. So you know it's going to bury about 5/8 of an inch.
Yeah. We'll go 26 3/4.
You just tighten that in a little bit every time you go around, is that what you're doing?
Just like copper tubing. The porta bands works too. You think port band would take that long?
Well, that depends on the blade.
I guess I don't pay for blades normally, so
change them whenever they get a little dull, huh?
Yep.
This is a reamer. And it just takes off that burr on the inside there. Even ratchets, huh? Do we rim it even if we use a porta band? Should it be rimmed
out? Yeah, I just want to knock the edge off.
Yeah,
so
man,
there's
that's
no
actually,
shirt.
Oh, that is cool. That is a hell of a reamer deal. Yeah.
Baby bucks move.
Does it fit?
Yeah, but I'm thinking we, because it's going uphill a little bit.
Yeah.
I'm thinking we want to put a bend in it to keep it down.
That's because ever who welded those stupid fittings on didn't get them on there straight. I'll have to talk to him about that.
Yeah, we're actually got our table mounted out here like we're going to use this boat. We took the caps out, used bolts, various assorted things to bolt the table down. Then our good old Dymi clamps to clamp down the pipe bender. It's a lot of leverage. God, it's bending that.
Yeah.
That's amazing. By hand. That's not your normal 1-inch pipe, that's 1-inch Schedule 80, so it's got a heavy wall on it. There you go. Brand new 14 teeth per inch blade in that DeWalt. And that's faster, isn't it? The trick is being able to cut it nice and straight.
I'm not used to everything not being square.
Welcome to boats.
That square is screwing with me. Because I just measure across and see, now we got that.
Now it's hitting the brace.
Yeah.
So we gotta take it apart and shorten that one.
Now that is not coming off. That is awesome.
Right angle clamps for electrical conduit.
So why the hell are we using it on hydraulic? It's not gonna work. They look galvanized, is that what that is?
Yep.
Now, check that out.
No drilling holes.
It pinches itself down. Goes on like that. So the U goes over the pipe, and this piece just clamps onto whatever plate of steel is around, which is angle iron in this case.
Beautiful little deal. And they cost about $5 a piece.
Yeah, around there.
Yeah. After 12 years, my handle finally broke. Oh, look at that. Sunny day ahead of us.
That rag had acetone on it.
Oh.
Now it's on the ground.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah, that's on fire. You know that, right?
Did you have it laying there while you're welding? Did I light that on fire, or did you do that?
I did that.
Oh, good job. Wasn't me, finally.
So we're gonna weld up a handle, but we're also gonna weld up some tubes here that Chris is making for holding a welding rod.
You think we've got enough fires around here lately?
Yeah, probably.
New handle. Now, I often hear that old saying, you know, a grinder and paint will make a welder what he ain't, or you're not a welder, you're a grinder. And it's like, all those things are true, but the truth is also that I've rarely seen a weld that I can't make look better with a grinder. So, unless you're one of those anal retentive, very slow TIG welders, I can make it look better with a grinder.
Chris is just showing off now. That's done with a MIG. Very carefully, one tack at a time all the way around. Looks like TIG. Okay, what did you make today? Huh? Look at that. Welding rod holders, aren't they pretty? And a new door handle, yeah. Awesome. Okay, we just changed out to a new set of dies, the cutting teeth in these things. About 60 bucks, 50 bucks on Amazon. 60 bucks if you go to Granger like we did, but they had them in stock. It's gonna get cut to 101, the rough length, and then he'll figure out where the bends need to be in it.
Got it.
So here's some vocabulary for you. If you bend the pipe once, it's called a kick. And so what we tried to do is, you know, my argument was he wouldn't do it. I said, okay, let's just bend this up and then kick it down and go right on across. That actually is a bad idea because the pipe needs to be spun into here and there's not enough clearance in there. So what we did instead was his original idea, which I gave into, is another bend here, and that's called an offset. So a bend and then a counter bend. And then the pipe just rotates neatly in its nice little, you know, 6-inch area, threaded in just fine. So a kick and two of them is an offset.
And us amateurs will want to actually measure the degree of bend we want to put in this. But he just knows it by what it looks like. Yeah, this is the forward cabin, and we've opened up the floor of our cargo hole all the way back to the engine room, and he's working on the bulkhead back there. Now, what happens is a coupler gets welded into the bulkhead, and then there's a union on either side. And there's a valve and a union. The valve lets us shut off the front end of the boat, and the union allows you to plumb into this coupler here. Still make it work. Because every time you get into a place where you can't spin the pipe or spin the fitting on, you're gonna have a union there to fix that problem.
Okay, the trick here is that this isn't in permanently, it's just in temporary, but when you have two fittings like this with a distance between them, that makes it easier to measure that distance.
And nipples are hard to thread on the pipe vise because you don't have enough top pipe to work with. So we're probably gonna go buy nipples.
About a 3.5-inch nipple there.
The thing I'm learning about laying out pipes is there's lots of different ways to do it. This T could be oriented like this. You have a street, have lots of parts around and try things that will work for you to make it easy for you. But trying to lay it out beforehand without actually fitting the pipes in is not the way it's done. It's done by actually testing things and seeing what works best.
Let's add a little bit of length to our nipple.
And then just do the T.
Electronics guy uses these pliers, and I have never seen them. He says they're all over the place. But the cool thing is, they got this little button on them, and you can change that, and it stays where you put it after you release the button, because it's got this little spring tabs and little ratchets in there. So what are these things called?
Nippix.
German. Yeah, I'm going to buy some. If you want some cool pliers too, I'll put the Amazon affiliate link in the description. Trim work on it. They put the coupler in there. He's using 6010 welding rod because it digs through paint and everything, so he doesn't bother grinding or any of that stuff. And you might be thinking, what the heck's the third hole for? And that, we decided to run air. So we're going to run an air line through the cargo hold up to the front too. And that's going to work out really nice, because then I can put my air tanks up in the forward crush zone of the boat. That won't take up space here in the shop. It'd be awesome. Okay, pipes that you put bends in, you bend the fitting up and twist the pipe in, and then when it's done, you can lay it back down where it's going to go, which is alongside that pipe down there.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, look at that. Oh, beautiful. Now you notice the trick that he bent the welding rod to get around the corner there. What we're doing is we're just welding on some little tabs, and it gives these clamps something to grab to. The professional tool pack. That'd be great. Except on a boat, the whole thing go in the water at one time. Oh, man. So a little piece of angle iron welded onto our upright there, and then see how that goes on there? It's just like magic. Oh my God, I don't think I've ever touched a snap-on tool before. This is allowed. You have to get licensed to touch these things? Is there a certificate I need? Something else I learned is pipe vices aren't just good for pipes. They can clamp anything in them. They even clamp the fittings to the pipes in there when they're tightening something small. So use your pipe vise for anything. And always when you cut a pipe off, go ahead and just put a thread on that end of it, because you're going to need to sooner or later, and it's already clamped. And this deburring is really an electrician's thing, because they don't want a sharp edge on that when they drag their wires through the pipe. So they put a big chamfer on there. But it's a good idea for hydraulics too, because there's no burr that might come off on the pipe later and screw up a pump. And Chris made us go buy Harbor Freight the other day just because he wanted to buy this. It's CRC cutting oil. Yeah, cutting oil. Because he swore by this. I kept getting him hassled because it's just snake oil. Oil is oil, you know. Pour some motor oil across it, it works fine. This stuff really is better for a couple of reasons. I'll show you one. Watch this. It foams up. See that? So you don't need to use so much. Ain't that cool? And it's sticky as can be. Look at that. It has these little spider web threads that come off of it. It's so sticky. So it really does get into the threads well. And so yes, it's good stuff. I'd still use motor oil just fine. They also like using it because on their jobs, everything in that bucket is hazmat. So it's gotta be disposed of, you know, EPA bullshit. And whereas here, I'd just pour it on the fire out back and, you know, light the fire with it. So, it cuts down on how much oil they have to dump in there. And, you know, actually it's $7 a can, I think. $7 or $8 a can from Harbor Freight. And so it's cheaper than if you're having to use new motor oil. You know, it's certainly cheaper than that. But if you got some old motor oil and you live in Oklahoma,
Yeah. And he's got a pair of nippers. They're like little bolt cutters. So he snips that stick off. Hello.
Hello.
Anytime he wants to make it, get rid of the bad end on it. Now we need a bend really close to the pipe, so the instructions were to put this union on here first, and then that'll keep it from slipping out of the pipe bender, and we can get as close as possible to the end without damaging the threads. Nice. If it weren't for Chris, we'd be using our Harbor Freight bender. This thing's nicer. Show you some more of this German tooling. What's this stuff called again?
Nippix.
They figured out something with the geometry of the jaws here that I'm just going to push down on the top of it, and it's locked. That is so strange. So, Nippix, if you're interested in it, I think I am. I just worry about spending a lot of money on tools that are going to go onto a boat, because, you know, you're always going to hear that kablink one day. Well, we put this fitting here too close to the hull because, you know, it gets narrower on the other side. So we didn't have room to spin a fitting on, so we cut an oval out. So now you just turn it over, you weld it back in like that, and you move the whole thing over. Now, if you think we planned that out like that, no, but it's a nice happy coincidence. So the end result on this other side is there's room to spin a fitting in now. I made this beautiful pipe today, and it was to go from there to there, right? To that union. But you got to be able to move the pipe a little bit to get the union to work. That little hump right there, right? That little piece just would not slide over because this section of pipe, because it's teed into the box, doesn't have any flex to go that way. So the fix that Chris gave us is this thing, 490s, just jog it off to the side, and then it has a little bit of flex. So this can actually move in and out because it has something to give. So what we gotta do tomorrow is heat this up a little bit right there, pull it a little sideways, or I could even unthread it and put it in the bender and bend it. You know me, I'm gonna go with the torch. Yeah, misty cold winter night. Well, not cold for the guy from Minnesota. Well, let's see what's going in the shop tonight. I saw a flickering of lights. Oh, that one over there looks nice. Yeah, Chris and I went down to Ready Arc today and visited with Tony and Buford. Dave wasn't there. Dave is the guy that fixes our welders when they break. Cool, love you, Dave. And Chris picked up a brand new used, what is this thing?
Dynasty 200.
It's a high frequency start TIG welder stick and 200 amps.
Yep.
And it runs off 220. Does it run off 110? It doesn't run off 110.
It'll run off 110.
It will?
Pretty sure. And it'll run off 480.
Yeah, 480. Who uses 480? Well, you're an electrician, so you use 480. But none of the rest of us even know what 480 is, do we?
I don't know.
Look at all these settings. It's a pulse.
Yeah, it'll run off 110.
Yeah, cool. Runs off 110. And it's a pulse welder, which is, you're going to love that for silicon bronze. I just love, because that's what my MIG welders don't do well is silicon bronze with pulse. Until they have pulse, rather. So, everything else, yeah. But he doesn't, if you don't like the scratch start, because you haven't taken the time to get good at it, this thing has a high frequency start, so all you gotta do is get the TIG torch near, boom. And it has the foot pedal on there, so you can control the temperature, mash down more, gets hotter, lift up, gets cooler. A lot of you have suggested that we use, you know, the foot pedal and the high frequency start, but on the boat, I don't want those things because there's a lot of electronics inside that box right there, and salt water is kind of hard on electronics, so I figure, and the other thing is, I can run a scratch start TIG off of our VMAC welder. So as long as I just get good at scratch start TIG, I think we'll be a lot happier on the boat. Now we can't do AC, and he can do AC on this box. You need AC in order to do TIG for aluminum. And that I can't do on the boat. I'll have to use MIG, which means the material better be 1/8 inch thick, or I just use real short, you know, tacks with it to try and weld. So there's a lot of advantages to these machines, but it's not really something I want to try and take on the boat because of the problems with all the electronics and so forth on it. You know, simpler is better when at sea. That is a weird, what the size tungsten is that? Is that 3/32?
That's out of your torch.
Yeah, really? So that's a therated tungsten, 2% therated tungsten then. And yeah, that's good, man. You're doing good. This is your first time TIG welding?
First time with a machine that can do a high frequency start, yeah.
Yeah, how do you like it?
It's better than scratch start, easier.
Well, it's just because you're not used to scratch start. Dave doesn't have any problems with it. You know, the guy, you know, Buford didn't have any problem with scratch start. He says you just put your cup there on the table and start it up.
Which one do you like the best? I don't think any of those are hot enough.
I think they're all
too
hot.
Do you?
I don't know.
I like that one there. I think that's wetted in nicely on the sides.
Mm-hmm.
See, that was too cold. What amperage are you running at?
Well, there's a whole bunch of different filler metals there, too. There's some stainless in there.
Oh, you're trying all kinds of things.
Yeah, there's some silicon bronze. That was silicon bronze. That was silicon bronze.
Where's the amperage setting? It just has two.
Oh, that was pulse.
Oh, I see.
So 200 is my peak on the pedal.
So if I press the pulse, it shows me...
two pulses a second.
Ah, and this is amperage. So you're not at 200 amps.
200 amps foot pedal control.
Oh, so then it's just how much you mash down.
Yep.
Okay. Now have you taken the foot pedal all the way down?
Down to low amperages?
I mean, to have you cranked it up to 200 amps?
Haven't tried that yet. You could be half an inch away and I'll start it.
No shit, really?
Yeah, try it.
I'll try it. Okay. Let's see how I'll walk this way. Yep, sure enough.
Oh, you got pulse on right now.
Yeah, I know I got pulse on. Should I have pulse on?
Oh, it makes things easier.
That's pretty... You know, I got the pedal master before.
You do?
Yeah.
So your average current with pulse on, your average current right now is 143 amps.
So that's what it's telling me?
That's what the average between the highs and the lows is. You set a percentage.
You got the post flow turned on too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Fancy stuff.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now we got to weld some fittings into our hydraulic stuff just because.
Oh yeah, we definitely have to now.
What?
Slow.
Yeah, I know. That's my gripe we got about it too. You can make them look great. Damn, is it slow. Unless you're Jody. Jody can TIG weld fast. But it's Jody, not you, Jody.
All right, there's this thing about sharpening your tungsten so the scratch marks go down toward the tip.
I think that's complete bullshit, okay? But if it makes you feel better, go ahead and do that.
How's working?
Yeah, oh my God, that feels so nice. Oh, I need to do something with a torch every morning.
Can you get it in from, oh yeah, you can put it in there.
I can. I'm just going to move over this side. Yeah?
Fuck.
No, that's all right.
This one's giving us fits.
Yeah, see, it's going down.
You need to pull straight.
Got it.
It's got it?
It's got it.
Ah.
Yeah, it's good, no? Okay, that only took a day.
Okay.
And there's no floor to stand on, it's flat.
That'd be considered a tripping hazard, and we would have to do a fall hazard, or a hazard analysis on that one.
Yes, I want my big.
Give me my big back.
Give me all the stupid little rods you finish with.
What?
It's all the stupid little rods you finish with, too.
Well, yeah, you gotta have a butt bucket.
You gotta have a helper. They go around and pick up all the stupid little rods.
Well, no, you have what's called a butt bucket.
The butt bucket?
Don't hang it there.
I know, that'll work. That's the other thing. Where do you put the damn thing?
There. You just go like this. You just hang it out whatever.
Hang it up whatever. You know, that's my
way. You don't have to beat it. You just rake it.
No, you have to beat it. Jody from Welding Tips and Tricks told me that.
Yeah.
Look at that, it's gorgeous. It's absolutely gorgeous. I'm not gonna show you the ones on the bottom.
I'm using my wrench wrong. Oh, it's backwards.
Yeah. Snap-on's gonna revoke your license, man.
Call Interstate Steel.
Call Interstates. Calling Interstate Steel and Metals.
We got some bad pipe. It will not thread. Even trying to break the trip chip on 90-degree rotation's bad. Hey Mike, this is Doug Jackson. How you doing today? I'm good. Listen, have you guys had any complaints about this Schedule 40 pipe you guys got? Or I'm trying to thread this stuff.
No. It gums up. It doesn't cut clean. It cuts like mild steel is composed. You know, if you're doing a cold roll. You know, it's you know, I've threaded Schedule 40 before, but never anything this bad. And I've done most of my threading with Harbor Freight crap. But what's funny is I got the good rigid tools today, and breaking the chip on after a 90-degree turn and everything, and it just gums up. So I thought maybe you had a bad batch. Yeah, you don't have anything seamless in stock. Yeah, that's the stuff you gotta bring in. No, I've been doing, who do I go to? Ameripipe. That's where I got the stuff, the other stuff. So I'll just go down there and get that. Well, anyway, note it. And if you have somebody else bitch at you about it, tell them to say, come. Yeah, we've heard that. Yeah, I'll keep this in hand though. It's no big deal. I'll just use it for legs on something. All right. Have a good day, Mike. All right. Bye-bye.
Okay, we're in the aft cabin, and this pipe is long, and it's got 245s bent into it. But you can do that. The trick to it is unhook your fastening places. So we have one there at the top and one down there at the bottom. And once it's unhooked, then this pipe can flop around. Store to buy a good pipe and a few more fittings,
like an everyday ritual now. Plumbing store.
We'll be happy when we get our floor back in there.
Well, those bushings, so they're going to be threaded bushings, and we'll just weld them into the welded fittings.
Right.
To the weld fittings. And if we get the carbon steel ones, then we can weld them versus cast iron ones. We'll go 12 of them, and then three. Perfect.
One thing I love about Tulsa, we got lots of shops that supply fabricators. And this is a Ameripipe. We're picking up pipe. It's an A106, the heavy steel wall pipe. We're also getting some Schedule 40 today for their airline pipe. But love this company.
And they're in Houston and San Antonio and even Florida now.
And this is Echo. Echo, say hello. Echo's not going to say hello.
Come on, Echo.
Mr. Mayor, you don't want to be on camera? You think we can get the pipe up on top of the truck? Yeah.
Hopefully this stuff threads better.
Be worse.
Yeah, be worse. Far crack. And it's already painted too. This is why we can't have nice things.
Why can't we have nice things?
Because people plasma cut all the squares. Almost impossible to find a square that's not.
This one's beautiful. Oh, it's got a little nick in it there.
Yeah, that's why I can't use that side.
There you go.
I have to use the harder side.
All right, I'll buy some more squares.
We have switched over to the fine cut consumables.
Take a much lighter curve.
And what we're working on is the, what do you call it, an expansion tank for the hydraulic system. So we have a steel hydraulic tank. Somebody gave us the fantastic idea of making a stainless steel second tank that goes above it. The fluids will rise and fall in the second tank, you know, when the deck cranes boom, extends or contracts. That's the only thing that consumes and puts back fluid. But it also is kind of like the, you know, it's the fill tank for the hydraulic system. But the deal is, even if water collects on the top of the expansion tank, because it will, because there's air coming through there, it'll condense up there. it's stainless, so it won't rust, so you don't add rust to your tank. The tank down below is steel, but it's nothing but solid fuel, hydraulic fluid, and that's really gets cooled against the ocean water. So best of both worlds. Fantastic idea from somebody out there. They said they do it all the time on their boats. Cool.
And we stopped by another supplier in town today called GM something supply house, and they do a lot of stainless steel fittings. So we got these half couplers, which is like a full coupler that's cut in half, and we'll weld those onto the tank to allow the fluid to go in and out, and also do us a fill port and a vent. And then these two things get welded onto the side, and we also got a glass sight gauge to go on the side, so that threads into there, and it'll have a glass tube. Once we get the tank built, we'll tell them how long that we need the tube cut for. And beautiful. Isn't that pretty? And there's our fine tip consumables. It has a little bit different nozzle and everything from the normal plasma torch setting, but it does have a much finer kerf. A little practice to start with.
See, this is a 16 inch one.
It makes a 22.
I saw that. That just looked insane.
They're fantastic. For 4 inch pipe, they're fantastic.
Well, well. I may have to get a pair for the boat.
For big stuff. Well, you don't need pipe wrenches then.
Yeah, that's true. You don't, do you?
Oh, they grip everything.
Yeah, but they're $100 for the 22s.
Oh, I know.
Yeah, this was 60 something, 65, something like that.
Yeah.
It's on Amazon if you want your pair. I'll tell you what, they are nice, but boy, they're expensive. Oh yeah, cool. All right, we made a mistake in here. What we forgot about is above us in the pilot house, there's a winch for the sails, and it comes down through a post that's mounted there, and there's the other side, so we're gonna put those T's right here. We're gonna come off these pipes and go up. That cuts much better than that grinder. Yeah, put a little piece of sheet metal up there and everything. Keep it out of the pipe. Fire blanket on the floor. It's gonna fit. I'll probably have to move it one way or the other. It has to go aft. Floor tiles later.
Okay.
Okay, so that finishes the aft cabin. So what we're going to do is we're going to run hoses off the ends of those pipes to cylinders that drive the rudder quadrant there. That thing in the middle is the rudder quadrant. It's connected to the post that's connected to the rudder. And then two more hoses that'll go back through fittings there in the deck. Oh, we can go ahead and put those in.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got to put some through holes in the back deck there to go up to the winch that runs the Davits winch.
What? This?
No, that's hydraulic.
This is the hydraulic.
Yeah. 160.
Well, now you're videotaping me. I don't do well with that. All right. I know what I'm going to do.
Add the math that way because there's shrink.
All right, you gotta get a load of this. What's it called when you come off like that and then go back in?
Three bend set.
A three bend set, and then there's gonna be, that's air, and it's gonna go down here. And the other magical thing is, see, he's got it to, it works around all the hatches. And over here, with, this is another three bend set then?
No, that's just an offset.
That's an offset.
And then there's another offset.
Then another offset. Yeah, so what happens is we put both the hydraulic lines stacked here, and there's a space underneath there so that the water can drain off the deck to the ports. And that air line travels down alongside here, and all three of these are going to run over and go up our main mast, and all three of them are also going to go on forward.
Because the other brilliant idea we had is put 100 gallon propane tanks in the forward crush zone up there, and they can be our air tanks. So the air line will go up there, and then we'll get an air fitting up on the deck too. I gotta give a huge thanks to Chris, because it's been wonderful learning all this stuff.
If you taught me right, I don't know.
Who knows?
We'll see. People on YouTube will let you know if you're doing it right.
Oh, yeah, they will. I mean, they do.
But the fancy cable's really nice.
It's still hot.
I guess
those are nice. You're doing a nice job there. Oh, he's tacking. He's got the amperage turned up to 170. And then a kick on the foot pedal gives you a nice hot arc across there. And with these things stick out so far that what we're going to do is we're going to build a recess into the corner of the tank so that these will be here instead of out there.
Have you had lightning hit the boat yet or no?
Not that I know.
Not that you know of?
Do you have to use cutting oil with it?
Well, if we put cutting oil on it, then we're gonna have to clean it.
Yeah, you have to clean it, yeah. Quick change.
There's no
way. Well, yeah, if you weld, I think you ought to weld it from the. We're putting a big baffle in this tank just so that if it blows a whole lot of oil up through the return line, yeah, it has to clear that before it can go out the vent.
Enough to trip the breaker.
Yeah.
There's
okay, there's a little. There's about 4 to 8 volts of power coming through the ground.
Actually, you know what we
it's shorter on the motor, but.
Where's that meter?
That's good meter for us.
Yeah, this is one of the problems of having professional electricians show up. Nothing's a problem until there's an electrician, and then it's all wrong.
All right, Bart, go for it.
Look, it's 11 volts. It's like, look.
That's on 6.
You're not going to get killed by 11 volts. I wouldn't put my tongue to it, but.
Well,
I don't generally go around putting my tongue. I
it
know.
Lights off.
He's got this. What is this thing called?
Non-contact voltage.
A non-contact. But see, that'll make you paranoid because the whole damn thing lights up. I'm like, come on.
Put it to a cord.
Well, I know, but.
You got to find they're spiraled.
Oh, that's right. So you got to find where the wire is. Yeah.
The hottest.
Non-contact voltage tester will make you paranoid, okay? just the way they are. There are, you can get killed by electricity if you don't know that, okay? There's my safety statement. If you're going to be paranoid of every damn thing that has electricity in it, stay the fuck off my boat.
Your safety is your concern. If it scares you, stay away.
I want to button this thing up and silicone the snot out of it, and we'll put it back in service. And Bart is cutting more studs because we're not done welding studs in yet.
And Chris is experimenting. Where's the tank?
Oh, there it is. It's on the floor down there. Chris is welding more on this tank. We went and got some stainless steel wire so we can do some fine welding around these things. Snippix pliers came in, and there's two types that I've learned. I thought I was ordering this one. This is a Nipix Cobra, and it is the one with the push button on it. And Chris says if you do get the push button on it, this screw right there, you need a little Loctite on that little one.
Yeah.
Yeah, so put a little Loctite on that. After a few years, that'll back out. But what I got is this. They don't have the push button. See, they got that thing. So it's more like the old school pliers. And they're okay. I just, not the ones I want. They still got the great jaws on them that'll lock onto everything. So I'm happy with that. And this is the bolt cutters he was using to snap welding rod off. Great little bolt cutters. I think they'll work great for cutting wire and fencing and welding rods and anything else. Quarter inch carriage bolt. Let's see if we can cut through that. No? Yes? Maybe? Oh, sure enough. Yeah. Snaps right through it. That's a pretty big bolt.
Now I see why that's what you bought.
Can't film this?
No.
All right, fine. Well, I won't film it.
This is not getting filmed.
All right.
I'm cutting studs.
He's cutting studs. We can film this. People learning the TIG weld can be bashful. I'm not bashful. I'll show you my TIG welds.
This is with backing. In other words, I put a piece of aluminum back behind there and I can weld just fine there. This is without it, and you can see it gets too hot and I start burning through, so I'm messing with the amperage.
I think I can make it where I can weld this without a backing on it.
And the competition here is his Dynasty 200, which is a really cool welder. It's pulse and it's stick and it's TIG. And it's from Ready Arc, which is our guys here in town that rent this stuff out. They're all over the nation. You can buy them. Maybe your guys are as friendly as ours and help you out on prices.
I think that's it. I just gotta, when the keyhole gets a little too big, you just stop, let it cool down. And that's where you can do it without a backing on it. Check that out.
You getting her?
Yeah.
Ooh.
Ooh. Ooh. What is that I'm using?
Scratch start. What you really need is you need a foot pedal so you can crack out of it.
Yeah, that would the gas just to stop it. Yeah, and get the gas over. But see right there, I didn't stop it. I just burned through it.
That wouldn't be hard to make a 2x4. That's all you need.
Why would I make it out of a 2x4 instead of just a switch with a spring?
Well, because you need a real high amperage switch. What Jody made his
out of? He's killing the whole thing.
He's killing the power.
He's killing this lead power.
Yeah, so you kill the lead power.
Well, that's
so
kind of an expensive switch, isn't it?
Well, not at...
What if we just had two plates of copper and slammed
it? Well, that's expensive too. What you do is buy the automotive battery disconnect switches that they sell. They're like $10. And you attach it to a foot pedal. That's what Jody did.
Power it up.
Yeah.
Do your... And then drop out
and then
the gas.
And then you drop it out and let the gas...
I don't think pulling the gas off... I mean, I'm sure it has...
It discolors it.
I give a shit if it's discolored.
Because if you don't have the gas there, it'll also cause sugaring.
I don't think that's enough to sneeze at. I know it's weaker and everything, but...
It gives it... Well, no.
I'm not fucking NASA. It's not NASA. You just got a tank to hold oil. It's not fucking NASA.
I was waiting for the punchline to come up.
Oh, it was coming. I knew it was going to come.
I knew it was too. I was just waiting for it.
You know, at this low amperage, this thing is just like super easy to start.
Oh yeah. Well, that's what's cool about having a foot pedal on a scratch start ring.
Yeah. The little filler rod at the end, and it keeps the burnout down. I think I'm ready for prime time.
So I used filler is because I got too hot at keyhole there. And then no filler at all through here. Got a little, two little holes right there, I think. I have to go back over that. And then a little filler at the end because the heat has no place to go at the end. And compare that to, that's a beautiful weld, dude.
Fit up is everything. But basically, you can do everything the fancy machine does with a non-fancy machine. It's just gonna be a little more picky. Stop, you know, instead of letting off the pedal. Just come to a stop, let it cool down a bit. I think it works fine.
Well, if you don't have a stick of wire, you don't have a rolling thingy, where do you get the metal from in that one?
You melt the two pieces together.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Looks beautiful.
I need some post foil.
Yeah, adjust.
And then turn it out.
Oh, okay.
4 seconds?
Jeez, that's a lot of post flow, man.
Jody does like 12.
Look, you're not Jody, okay?
Okay.
The air gauge is on there. We've done some soap testing. Now we're patching up a few leaks. They're always in the corners. There's one there, there's one here.
Break one of those on the inside there. We're actually a bowl jar right here.
Yeah.
I just let the spring there take up the slack.
That's perfect. I would just do a tab from there to there.
Go down to the floor?
Go to this tank right here.
Well, I got a floor tile that goes underneath there.
Oh, do you?
And I want to be able to roll material back underneath it there. So I want to go to the... I want to go to that tab back there. You want to put a tab up to here and bolt it through there? I think we can do that easy enough.
Yeah.
Got it.
And pull the center up.
Chris is rolling out today. Been an awesome crew.
I'm going to the north here.
All right. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate your support. So you can like and subscribe and all that other YouTube stuff. But you can also go to our store at SV Seeker, and you'll see a tab for junk store, and get our hoodie. It's now on sale, $39. Get it in time before it starts warming up. Boy, I'm looking forward to start warming up. That would be so nice. But, and we also have, if you like, we're looking for additional support on Patreon. And if you don't like Patreon, that's okay. I'm cool with that too. You can do it with PayPal or lots of other things. There's a link in the description. So if you like the idea of being part of the boat the internet built, a research vessel on the ocean that operates for free, you think that's cool? Cough up a buck a month for us. We appreciate it. Thanks.